वेरी गुड एयरपोर्ट फैसिलिटीज और एनी अदर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर फैसिलिटीज इन अदर द नीड फॉर नेशनल डेवलपमेंट एंड इकोनॉमी ऑफ कोर्स यू टेक एनी इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर वॉट एवर इट इज इट मे बी ब्रिजेस हाईवेज इवन सीवर लाइन्स पेवमेंट्स एंड ऑल सो एवरीथिंग कम्स एंड फॉर्म्स एज अ पार्ट ऑफ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ओके सो फॉर एनी डेवलपमेंट ए नेशनल डेवलपमेंट यू नीड अ स्ट्रांग इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर And for a very good economy, you need maintenance because so you actually have to anticipate here, but you should not let it happen. So to keep it, maintain it, only when we maintain the infrastructure in a proper way, we'll have very good economy because the sudden failure will cause a great loss not only for a particular city or a district level. So it also causes the major greatest economic loss okay and so wherever we have very good infrastructure so those cities will have very good developments also so the important points in infrastructure and development is coming to the point of maintenance the developing countries actually suffer from a lack of sufficient infrastructure to attract investment and provide a basis for economic growth So you take in India, so we do have largest port in Mumbai, the Maharashtra port, Jawaharlal Nehru port, and Madras port, Visakhapatnam port. So these cities, if you take, so they do have very good infrastructure, not only in terms of harbor. So although we have very good airport facilities or any other infrastructure facilities in other major cities also. The cities which comes under coastline, especially the Mumbai, Chennai, or Visakhapatnam, we do have very good harbor facility because ships transport huge amount of cargo. So in that scenario, we'll be having very good infrastructure development that supports the economic growth. So countries that have been developed for quite a while often suffer from inability to properly maintain and replace the aging infrastructure they have. So that is the major problem even in our day to day life when we go to any government offices so I just wanted to point out this so when you go to any government offices you can see some deterioration in the concrete structure you can see some reinforcement in old buildings some cracks even newly built apartments 2 years back when I go for inspection during Chennai floods so I have seen many apartments which were just 2 years of old do have water leakage problem water seepage the penetration of water through the walls so the dampness was high just in case of 2 years of age okay. So this is we cannot only blame the design part alone we have to concentrate on the site execution the quality of materials you are using the climatic and environmental condition in which you are preparing yourself so these are the factors that we have to consider the same thing has to be followed for maintenance of bridge structures also so infrastructure as I said infrastructure is not only about bridges or highways or nuclear reactors or any power plants It also includes your sewer lines, water supply systems, very good grid connections, so power grids, gas supply system, and communication system. All this combined infrastructure, which helps a nation, for a very good development. So how does it helps the economy is all about how you are actually maintaining it. So coming to the bridge inspection. Because our course is about specifically about bridge maintenance. Okay, so coming to the bridge inspection, systematic observation of condition and behavior of various components parts of a bridge, that is called as bridge inspection. Because you add any other structure and you call a structural inspection or so observation in the sense. Suppose if you are going for an inspection of a building, okay, you take in terms of building. So you go there and you observe where is the cracks occur, whether there are any visible deflections are there. So these are called as observation. Systematic observation means, so from engineering point of view, you should start from the basic point, like so footing observation. So how is the footing is being constructed? So columns, what are the the width of the cracks that are being developed. So in case of any deterioration, what is the length, the width? So this systematic observation for each and every structural members has to be observed. Okay. So when you go for simply a site visit where you just go and see whether this particular structure needs a maintenance or rehabilitation, that is called observation. Technically, when you follow some procedures and depends upon the structural members, when you note down what are the different deterioration has been happened, that is called systematic observation of condition. So condition in the sense, so you take a bridge. So in case of, suppose if there is an lorry accident where a lorry was comes in a truck comes under over speed and it's the pier. Okay, so in that scenario, how was the pier as damaged? So whether the median has damaged, so whether that vibration effect has been transferred to girder, and in turn whether girder has transferred the same accidental load to the deck slab. So this kind of observation and this kind of conditions you have to note down. Okay, in the scenario of an accident, what are the, how the accidental loads will be transferred to the top or to the bottom? So these conditions has to be observed. And behavior of various components in case of that particular accident. Okay, or suppose you take the structure that is constructed near to the sea. Okay, over a prolonged period of time, due to a high salt nature of wind. Okay, so how the structure gets corroded? So whether the reinforcement is in good condition. So in case if there is any visible deterioration patterns, like reinforcement is visibly observed. Okay, in that scenario, so what are, how the deck slab will behave? So such kind of analysis and design has to be made. So this is what systematic observation of condition and behavior of various components or parts, that is your structural members. So inspection or maintenance work of bridges has often been a more ongoing process conducted many a times by those who cease to be technical or almost. See, in our nation, we do have standard codes for design of structures. Any structure you take, a design of pre-stressed concrete members, steel structure, reinforced concrete, even for timber and masonry, we do have codes. So we do not have a sufficient protocol, or we do not have any codes for maintenance or rehabilitation, right? So when you take, if you go for a ASCII codes, so ASCII has developed a certain standards. So when an engineer goes for inspection, okay, he has to follow and observe or record this information in the recording patterns. So this is what the engineers has to follow. These conditions has been given in ASCII. Not only in ASCII, even European codes have developed such cases. So why this point is important is, in India, suppose you may be graduated with a very good knowledge of such rehabilitation protocols or procedures, but when you join a company, we do not have independence of applying our own knowledge in any inspection. So you go for joining your company, so each company have different protocols in inspections or maintenance. Maybe a few inspections like maintaining the deck slab. Okay, so you lay off the top, get rid of the top layer of the road, you again apply the bitumen, you either apply for concrete. So such protocols may be same for all the companies, but the way the companies follows in India is completely different and depends upon the company as well as the leading engineer. So that is what this point I want to mention. Well, aims of bridge inspection. So we talk about inspections. So what does it has to aim? To assess structural soundness and fitness for use. So the structural soundness and fitness for use. When the bridge was actually analyzed and designed and constructed, so maybe for 100 years, we consider the period of 100 years for a specific amount of traffic. So over a period of time, maybe after 5 years or 10 years, the volume of traffic might be increased twice or thrice than we actually designed. In such a scenarios, we have to inspect and we have to observe whether the structure is still sound and fit for use. To identify trouble at the earliest stage. Okay, so normally what happens is, so suppose if you go for any site visit in case of any accident or deterioration, we concentrate only on that particular member. For example, if a girder have a visible reinforcement which is corroded, okay, so there we what happens is we will just touch off the particular girder with a cement grouting and we will close up. We do not analyze so how it will behave. Okay, so in case of any accident happened for the pier, we only concentrate on that particular pier, but you have to note down that that pier is supporting the deck slab which transfers the load to the girder. Okay, so your trouble, so the troubles will not be considered only for a particular member. So when an accident or a deterioration is about to happen or started to happen, in that scenario, so that particular member, what it affects, so what are the other members are interlinked. So this is how we have to actually do inspection. So to keep a systematic record of condition and behavior, so that is data bank. So what I mean by data bank is, so now we have very good cloud services technologies. So you have Google Drives. Okay, so in that scenario, routine maintenance of a bridge is mandatory. So when you go for when, because one bridge is being constructed and it is ready to use, maybe one assistant engineer or sectional engineer goes for inspection and he observes his pattern. Okay, and after 3 months, he has been transferred or he has been relocated to some other place. Another engineer comes and he inspects. So the and again he notes down his own observations, and again he might go over after 2 years or 3 years. When another engineer comes after 5 years, so he will not be knowing what was actually happened in the period of 0 to 5 years. So we have to maintain a data bank to plan repair and rehabilitation strategy and program. See, for every structure, the way of inspection may be common, but the working principle, for example, you go for grouting and additional reinforcement, FRP. So these kind of things you can go for concrete bridges or precast concrete bridges. So what happens in case of suspension cable bridges? So what happens in case of completely steel girders or steel bridges for railway lines? Okay, so for each bridges, and that depends upon the material and depends upon the load in which it has been designed, individual protocols has been observed. So this particular point I have taken from ASCII codes. If you're in this particular course, we do not discuss about ASCII or any Indian standard codes. Okay, so if you're interested, I will share you in the next session, or probably by today evening in the Google Classroom, where they have their own set of protocols. So how the bridge inspector has to go and inspect. Okay, so that you can refer for your own references. So these are the aims of a bridge inspection. And of course, the inspection includes going to bridge. You cannot sit in your office room and instruct someone to go, and you cannot take decision based on that. As an engineer, you have to go to the site and you have to decide. then see the bridge with an eye of the doctor with unaided as well as an aided eye. That means when you go to the bridge inspection, you have to observe and you have to witness what are the visible deterioration that are being witnessed or visible in the bridges from a layman level. Okay, don't think from the engineer level. So first you observe. Okay, so I have noted some cracks has happened, some reinforcement is being witnessed, so I can see some layoff in the deck slab. Okay, so such things you have to note. Then you assume yourself as a doctor of that particular structure. Now you noted down what are the visible things from layman point of view. Then as a doctor, okay, so that is as a structural engineer, you go and technically you start measuring. So what is the width of the crack, how much deck slab has been laid off due to flood or prolonged movement of water. Okay, so this is what you have to do. Then systematic observation over a period of time. So this is what I mentioned in the previous slide also. So you have to periodically go visit and take records and observations of the bridge maintenance and put it in the cloud, so where it is universally maintained. Okay, so that any other engineer who comes for next level of maintenance can see and take decisions. So finally, so this is very important. As I said, you should not sit in your office room, instruct someone and take decisions based upon their observations. Okay, so you have to go see and observe what's happened. The sequence of inspection. So this is what I mentioned in the previous slides. So what are the protocols you have to follow for a systematic observation? So see a foundation and flooring, substructure, protection and training works, bed blocks, bearing and expansion arrangement, superstructure, track in case of railway line. Okay, or a deck slab in case of common road bridges. Okay, so foundation, you have to take care of pile caps, the pier caps. Okay, so pile cap is very important. That's why if you observe in metro rail bridges, especially where the metro rail flyovers are going within the city limits. Okay, so you can see the medians are almost 4 to 5 feet high. The medians that covers the pile caps. Okay, so they do not construct it just for some reason. So it was constructed to prevent any accident that causes damage to the pile cap. Okay. So substructure. So substructure arrangements in case of any grounding. Okay, so in case of any deflection in the footing levels, so that observation we have to make. So protection and training works. So what are the protection methods? Suppose you have a piers, okay, inserted into the ground, and you have a heavy road vehicular movement in a area. So there, in that scenario, you can do some protection measures. You can construct a very thick median. So additional reinforcement, okay, or dummy columns, that you can do. And this training works has to be given to the maintenance engineers also. Bed blocks comes for the railway tracks. So where you have ballast, okay, ballast is laid off and sleepers are connected. So that bed blocks, whether it's in a proper alignment, okay, that we have to check. So bearing and expansion arrangement. So you have roller supports at one end of the girder. So how does that roller behave? Whether it goes for any corrosion or the bearings, does the bearings have any impurities? Or suppose in case of flood, any wooden logs or anything comes and stands in between the bearings. Expansion arrangements, as I said, the roller supports. So in case of roller supports, how actually it works and whether there has been any damage caused. So superstructure, the girders and deck slabs. So finally, for railways, you have tracks. So apart from your actual bridge elements, you have to check your tracks also. So that also comes under the scope of a bridge engineer. Okay. So planning to inspect, inspect. So when you go for planning of inspection, you should have these questions in your mind: when to inspect, how to inspect, whom to take along for inspection, what to take along for inspection, and again, when you go for inspection, your aim should be what to inspect. Okay. So as I said in the beginning of this presentation, so I said that we will be discussing about the Kolkata flyover accident that happened in 2016. So this is a visual image of that particular accident. So I guess you all are aware of this particular accident. So Vivekananda Road flyover has been under construction since 2007. You imagine the period of time. It started construction from 2007. The accident has happened as an under construction flyover in 2016. It was still not get constructed. It's not open for traffic. When it was under construction itself, it got failed. Can you see the transit mixers and some lorries also get under the failed structure? So you can see the main causes where some studies was. So you can see from the girders itself. So all the girders, you can see that blue color girders, you can see some small elements. So that brace, they are bracings actually. So if you observe, they provided only horizontal bracings, and lack of vertical bracings were observed in all the girders where the flyover was hands and curvatures. So there they have actually avoided vertical bracings. And we do not know what is the reason behind that. So unlike most flyovers in India, this particular flyover has a steel pier cap design. Okay, due to obvious reasons of saving time and ease of erection in a populated area, that is a very well populated area. Okay, so I think that is the reason why they used steel piers. So as a nation, I guess the experience and skills required for steel construction appears to be inadequate and insufficient. So even in our classrooms, when we take a session, so people are very much comfortable with the RC design instead of steel or pre-stress. So some people even find pre-stress to be more comfortable and easier, but still there are many situations where people still are not comfortable with the steel design. I'm not sure whether the course is not interactive or not interested and all, but in this particular case study, I guess that still the knowledge for steel construction appears to be inadequate and insufficient. I'm telling this from my experience with some of the best contractors and their reservations on use of steel. Okay, so we must remember that the project commenced in 2007, and with elections in front, the government would have exerted pressure for faster progress. In most cases where welding was involved and there was time pressure, the welders do not follow the process. I have seen welders inserting rods, MS rods or TMT rods, where they have to do butt weld for 50 to 75 mm thick plates. So instead of going for welding, they just insert the rod and they will seal it. As far as quality control is concerned, we know the state of affairs in this class. After a few initial tight quality checks, the balance work go without any quality check in this particular constructional failure. So for an engineer, it is imperative to explain the design criteria on drawing in form of construction notes. This is extremely important as the site people cannot assume anything with regard to the design conditions. So why I am telling you this particular point is, so in the next slide I will show you a picture and I will explain you. Okay, so the engineering drawing must explain the construction philosophy and sequence in special cases. I know that the site don't like to see many notes with regard to construction sequencing, but for the safety of the structure and to make things more accountable, it is imperative to have such notes that explains the site engineer the need for this particular system. For example, if you have to design a deep sump, okay, so you assume that you are going to design a deep sump with a top slab, and in the design the sump wall is considered to be a propped cantilever. It is necessary for a design engineer to put a note regarding backfilling, that unless top slab is backfilling can't be done. Such notes will not be liked by contractor, but engineer must inform under what condition the structure can be subjected to loading. So can you imagine what I'm telling? So you are going to construct a deep sump, okay, so you have designed in such a manner that you know that backfilling cannot be done unless you cast a top slab. Actually, so most of the contractors do have some common sense and they will follow, but majority of even some 3 to 4 years back when I go for an apartment building construction at OMR Chennai, so when the the underground sump, water sump was constructed, and when we go for inspection, we noted that the side walls of the sump started deflecting. See, they just started construction, the footing, not the building has not even started. So even then the structure started deflecting. It's because before constructing the top slab, they started backfilling it. Okay, because they wanted to urge the construction to be finished faster. Okay, so in this scenario, it is important for a structural design engineer to give some notes in the design drawing. So a very hyped but never practiced topic in India is HS, health, safety and environment. You have a safety engineer with white cap, environmental engineer with green color helmets, okay, but their duty is they will come, they will check and go, they will write whatever the observation. But again, those are the people from the same company, they are your own teammates, okay, so we do not take such safety measures very seriously, isn't it? So that's one of the reason why such failures are being happened in bridge constructions or flyovers. So do we anticipate failures? If so, the traffic below under construction portion would have never been permitted. You can see a transit mixer below the failed girder, right? So from this photos, it appears that before concreting, the top flanges of the plate girders were not braced. So that is what I have explained to you in this particular image. So this is how the particular pier has been collapsed. So at the right bottom corner, you can see the complete rotation and collapse of cantilever arm. You can see it's a complete steel structure. Fine. So this is the failure patterns. So starting from the top left to the right bottom, you can see the failure patterns. Okay. Unfortunately, in India, the inquiry commission results will not be published and may not even be accurate, as they do not engage good engineers. So as a common Indians, you common people, you all have known that, right? We do not have any good engineers in inquiry commissions, but we do have retired judges. They are masters in law, but we don't know whether they're technically sound. So who may not have any knowledge about behavior of this structure? Okay, political and legal issues stand apart. Technically, what sounds more is there is no element of doubt that this flyover collapse has been triggered by the failure of pier cap, that is pier cap number 40. Whether it is faulty design or faulty material or faulty connection, it is a matter of further probe. But apparently, the depth of pier cap at pier face for a 5 meter cantilever, that means almost 15 foot, appears too less, and therefore design failure is a strong possibility and an intelligent guess. The structure has given, actually the structure has given sufficient warning of almost 6 to 7 hours before the failure has happened. The sequence of event led to failure clearly demonstrate that any sensible and intelligent site engineer present there with some basic sense of engineering could have understood the signal given by the structure and perhaps could prevent this calamity. See, for a structural engineer, you what I wanted to tell you is you may be master in analysis and design. Okay, that's well and good to get a very good lucrative job. Okay, but you have to understand how the structure behaviors and what are the sense of engineering, the signals that a structure could give. So in case of deflection, okay, such failure patterns, all these things I've observed. See, normally to my students I usually tell this statement: there is no matter, anyone can use StatPro or ANSYS, even an 8th standard student or a 9th standard student can use it. But what makes you different is an engineer, especially a structural engineer, must know how to infer the results. You get the results, you get deflection, you get the design pattern, but you should have a sound knowledge of judgment whether this design is right or up to the limit, whether I can make any modification, whether I can go for change in materials, whether I can decide upon use of any composites. See, this decisions has to be taken from your analytical results. That's why when you practice ANSYS or Abacus, see, you are into your second year, so you might be working on your projects as well. So when you go for ANSYS or Abacus, it's not an tough task to get your results. With certain tutorials, you can actually get results very easily, right? But to make your knowledge very soundful, you must know if this beam, which is constructed of steel fibers, is getting failed when for a particular amount of load is applied. But I want the same beam to withstand the load even if it exceeds. So what should I do? Whether I can go for composite material? Do I need to increase the grade of concrete? So why the structure gets deflected? Okay, so you should have that common sense. So okay, so this is the limit where the structure starts showing deflection. I should stop applying the load. You cannot keep on going applying the load, and you cannot wait till the structure gets failed. This was happened in this bridge collapse. Okay, the failure occurred when concreting of deck slab above the steel girders was on, or concreting has just finished. The concrete was still green state when the failure took place. As I said, the structure has given sufficient warning of almost 6 to 7 hours before the failure. When concreting was halfway, the bolts in girder, I mean the cross girder, you can see in that blue color slabs, no? That cross girder of the steel girders placed on cantilever pier cap sheared off. This apparently happened because of excessive deflection of the pier cap, because it could not withstand the overload of the concreting, fresh concreting. Okay, so over which these longitudinal girders were placed. So apparently what the site engineer did, you know, instead of trying to find out the reasons behind the bolt failure in the pier cap, he has given instruction to weld the bracing again and go ahead with concreting. Do you understand? The pier cap, that particular 40 pier cap number 40 has given a sufficient warning of a bolt failure between the girder and the pier. Okay, so the site engineer has observed this, but still he has given a green signal of go ahead with concreting just by bracing or bolting. Okay, so this is what a structural engineer be soundful. So you have to understand why the structure, before getting functional, it gets failed. Okay, so you have to stop your concreting and you have to analyze what is the behavior of structure. Instead of that, the site engineer has instructed to weld the bracing again and go ahead with concreting. So if you look into this picture, you can observe the pattern of shear failure and ductile failure that happens. So here in the box where I mentioned, structural failure is due to combination of flexural ductile failure and shear failure. So can you see the pattern? So this pattern is much very good example of a shear failure. Okay. So and in white color box where I rounded. If you see that particular I could not get a very clear picture. So you can see here as well as here. Okay, so in these two scenarios, you can see that the material has yielded beyond its limit. So you can see the cantilever flanges was very thin. Why? Because the ductile, it's a ductile failure. So when you have a steel member, when due after failure, when the actual thickness gets reduced, it's because of the ductile failure. Whereas if you observe this section, you can see uneven shearing of the member. Okay, so this member and this member, you can see, right? So these two, you can, if you observe, it's because of the shear failure. So this is what, as a structural engineer or bridge engineer, you have to develop the knowledge. So when you go for a site, as I said, in the previous slides, you must, when you go for observing how the failure has happened, so you should immediately come to a conclusion that, so what is caused the failure. So from these patterns of failure, you must have a sense of knowledge that it is occurred because of shear failure. And how come? How come this particular failure has happened? So from your site inspection, you must come to a conclusion that, see, the actual thickness was almost 8 mm or 10 mm, but the edge of this particular member has reduced to 5 mm or 6 mm. So that reduction has happened because of the ductile failure of the member. So this common sense you have to develop. So in our classes, I will show you some of these pictures, okay? And then I will explain what are the different failure patterns has happened in different bridges, okay? So you come across any such images or any failure also, you are welcome to discuss in our class. Okay, so when to inspect? You have a bridge where you want to go for an inspection, okay? So when to inspect? For bridges over water, the times of low water, when the water current or water flood level is very low, okay, you have to go and observe how the pier, whether there is any deterioration, any leak, penetration of water, any corrosion. So these aspects has to be considered. So bridges requiring high climbing winds or extreme temperatures are not likely. Suppose if the bridge requires, you have a tower or suspension cables, cable bridges. So you cannot go and inspect on the top of the bridge, right? In that scenario, you'll be going to use, cradles. Okay. Then bridges suspected of having trouble on account of thermal movement during thermal extremes. So where, suppose you should have a frequent visit to bridges which are high exposure to thermal events or highly exposure to sea conditions, which is placed close to water or sea. So that kind of bridges you have to inspect regularly. So how to inspect? Okay, so this is what I told you. When the water level comes low, okay, here this bridge you have to inspect, okay. Now, in these bridges, you can see the water level is low. So only at that kind of scenario, you can go and actually inspect. See here. Can you see in all piers you have these levels? Okay. So these levels indicate that that was the maximum or high flood level that came across that particular bridge. So here also you can see the same kind of pattern. And in the same bridge, if you observe, you can see a different color here, here, right? So this kind of scar materials, so when it it is exposed, these pier caps are much exposed. You can see the pier caps here. Okay, so these inspections has to be made. So that's why when the water level is low, you have to go and inspect how the piers are there and whether it have any deterioration and what about the pier caps. Okay, so this kind of observation has to be made, fine. And you have to observe then girders, you have rails, so all these observations has to be made. And this is one of the example of railway bridges. See, normally in India, in railway bridges particularly, we do have this kind of arrangements. So where you have a steel ladder connected throughout the bridge, entire bridge, you'll be having this kind of setup where the engineers will go have a look around the bridges, the girders, whether there is any deflection because of rail movements or any cracks has happened or any penetration of waters or any corrosion, any witness of reinforcement. So these things can be easily inspected in railway bridges. And after that, this is what I told you. You have to use cradles when the bridge height is very high. As an engineer, you cannot go alone and inspect, right? You should need cranes or girders, I mean cradles, right? So here, this is also a similar situation in any of the bridges, especially the railway or rail cum road bridges. They have fit a permanent cradles. Okay, so you have to go to the cradle and you have to observe the pier tops where your girders are actually resting, and you have to observe the bearings also. You can see here, you have to go and observe how the girders rest and the bearings present here. So this is another typical example of a railway bridge. So this is what I told you. So most railway bridges you take in India, you will have such kind of arrangement. You can see the walkway, rail walkway, and you can see the cradle systems here. Okay, and you can have a look on ladder. So this kind of arrangements will be very common in railway bridges. So here also, this is also another set of example of a rail bridge. This is actually a rest in a steel girder, right? So here you can see the place where ballast is located, and here you can see, right? So this this one and this one, so these two are called as bed blocks. So in the previous slide, we have discussed about bed blocks, right? So bed blocks will provided on top of the girder, where the rails will be fixed and ballast will be made available. So another example for steel cradles, and this is what I told you. So in case of very height, you have to move to higher height or lower heights, so you have to use your mobile cranes. In railways, we call it as OHE, overhead equipments. So this is another typical example. So why I am given you the range of platform here is because, so when you go for inspection of a very long bridge where and very high depth bridges, so where it is constructed in rivers or hill areas, okay, so when you hire or when you take a crane for inspection, you should have a knowledge. Just like that, you cannot call a contractor and ask for a mobile cranes. Okay, you should know what capacity that crane should have, because when you go for an inspection, you shouldn't get stuck at some point. So when you go there, you should have the vertical axis of 180 degree to 360 degree. So only then complete your inspection for the entire height of the or depth of the structure. So these scenarios also, as an engineer, we must consider.